What's up, guys, and welcome to the behind the scenes of Star Wars Imperial Encounters. This was the biggest animation I've ever made, so I'm pretty hyped for this. Okay, enough of the intro, let's get into it. This was actually the very first thing I animated for this entire project. I just added the blood on his face later on. I wanted to do it ahead of everything else just to see how awesome it would look. And I already had the whole story in mind, so it was fine to do so. And for this shot, I used this scene from Attack on Titan as reference. Here's a zoom out of the set in this scene. And as you can see, I really had to extend out the roof since there's nowhere near enough space on the actual building. And the top of this building is duplicated and moved up so you can still see it from camera view. Movie magic. Lastly, when the TIE interceptor shoots the roof, I have these stair blocks that are separate from the actual set, parented to it. Also, yes, the set moves too. It's not just the camera. It actually took some precision. It's harder than you think. This shot is way simpler than you think. It's literally just a PNG of stars with another PNG of Nar Shaddaa in front of it. Not much to be said here, but this text is parented to the camera as it slowly pans in. Okay, there's a lot in this scene. First off, this droid was inspired by TD from Star Wars Visions, so it's not a Kenan droid, which makes it seem more original. And I'm calling it TD-1 because it sounds just like BD-1. This rain that we got comes from this big old plane in the sky, and it's in the exact same shape as the streets so that we don't get any rain particles in the interior of some of the places in the city. Also, by the way, this set is a lot smaller than you'd think. It was very well made. So huge shout out to this guy for helping me out on it. Couldn't have done it without him. Populating the streets was really tough. I used the old BPS rig for most of the extras to prevent lag. We have a few Easter eggs scattered around. These are just some Weequayan pirates. This is Hondo and Star-Lord having a conversation. They're bonding over their big red jackets. This pirate is vandalizing this blank sign with the symbol that is seen in the Book of Boba Fett. This is a drunk Trandoshan. Here we have a Han shot first kind of situation, although neither are really supposed to be Han or Greedo. This is a random Twi'lek. This is another Trando. And this is actually something quite interesting. This DJ droid is not actually a DJ droid, but a pilot droid that's been repurposed as a DJ droid. And that's not at all an original idea. It was inspired by DJ Rex from Oga's Cantina at Galaxy's Edge. Okay, so the guy that my character is selling the coaxium to is actually supposed to be Cassian Andor, but it turns out he didn't become part of the rebellion until 5 BBY. And this is set in 6 BBY. Yeah, unfortunately, I made this scene right before Andor came out. So let's just say he's here on Nar Shaddaa buying coaxium so he can sell it for a higher price so he can get by on Ferrix. Let's go with that. Now for scene 3, this trooper stepping in like this was actually animated off of me doing the same kind of motions IRL. And I did the exact same thing for these troopers too. It's my first time doing something like that, and it helps a lot, so I might do it more in the future. This pistol was modeled after the A280 CFE in pistol form, and it's my favorite gun in Star Wars. And it's the same one that Cassian uses throughout Rogue One. Okay, I actually have no clue how I did this facial expression thing. It was over a full year ago as of recording this that I animated this scene, but here's the material. Yeah, I have no memory of doing this. The Arabic writing on this box translates to stuff. Very creative label for a box, I know. This was supposed to look like a remote droid, but I think it's safe to say I totally messed it up. Okay, for all the dismemberment in this animation, I have the actual rigged arms scaled down into the torso. Where are they? I actually can't find them. Well, they're there somewhere. And these two objects take their place between frames. This was definitely the longest action sequence in this animation. If you noticed, the street here looks like it's been rained on. And I remember following a tutorial for it. Here's the material if you want to copy it. For these doors, I actually just took a screenshot of the actual iron doors in the Minecraft Star Wars DLC and just slapped them onto the model. I forgot how I really did this saber trail, but as you can see, it involved rigging, which I have always not been good at. And it was a very long process to animate each of these bones. Basically, every 2 frames, I would move this bone to where the blade was two frames ago. And then I did the same thing with the other two bones, which gives it the flowing effect. When he stabs and slices open this trooper, this shot is actually just a scaled up mesh of the torso. And the camera's focal length goes down and then up to give the saber a sense of traveling distance. And also, yeah, this is just an arm. This shot of me slicing up the scout trooper was a recreation of Luke's attack animations in LEGO Star Wars The Skywalker Saga. Speaking of...
LEGO Star Wars Collection check. Newest set. Oldest set.
Smallest set.
Biggest set. Wow, this cost me a lot of money. Least favorite set. Favorite set. Yeah, sorry, Razor Crest.
TROS section. Mos Eisley section. Rogue One section. Jakku section. TIE Fighter. Sail Barge. And Sarlacc.
Death Star Throne Room.
Oldest figures.
First figure.
Rarest figures. Bib Fortuna. Jabba the Hutt. Bausch. The Rancor,
pretty much everything in Jabba's Palace.
This Boba Fett with arm and leg printing is really rare.
That's not a Star Wars set. I should replace that with like an AT-AT or something. This is a lightsaber.
This is a gun.
3 weeks later.
Okay. I'm displaying this differently, and I ended up getting that AT-AT. Yeah. And yeah, that's the collection.
For this scene, I made the very first character rig I've made ever from scratch. Pretty proud of myself for making it, but I don't think I could do it again. Oh yeah, when he picks me up, it's a separate rig that's parented to the KX Scuri Droid's arm. When the KX Scuri Droid gets cut in half here, I did pretty much the exact same thing I did earlier, and the rig itself gets swapped out with an unrigged version that's in two separate pieces. And yeah, since it's off camera, once it falls, it moves out of the way, so there wasn't any clipping going on in this shot. Now in this scene, when the Death Troopers come off of the TIE Reaper, they have to switch to a rig that isn't parented to it. So the ones that are parented to it, when they're about to step off, are scaled down into the platform, and one with the exact same pose takes its place. And when it's all put together, it looks really smooth. If your eyes are quick enough, you might have noticed that in between these two shots, there's a simple shot here that gives the overall slice some more impactful effects. Speaking of, these are two separate rigs, one with the top half deleted, and one with the bottom half deleted. Not that it matters at all, but it was in between this shot and this shot that I went to Disney World to get the footage of DJ Rex from earlier in this video. Anyways, I'm getting distracted. When the Death Trooper falls, there's this blood splatter here that was done by just scaling up these meshes. Super simple. And these, by the way, are actually just the blast marks on the Death Trooper. So, this is the scene that introduces the fifth brother. And the reason I have this animation set in 6 BBY specifically is because he dies in about a year or so from this point in the timeline. When the fifth brother flies up in this shot, these meshes are placed next to each blade, which gives it a cool spinning effect. After this shot, it goes blank, and that's because this shot I animated before getting started on this scene, similarly to that very first shot I did. And for this shot, I used this scene from Chainsaw Man as reference this time. The way I achieved the look of this blood gushing out was with scaling up and down these cubes on the x-axis, which makes it look like it's flowing when it's really just being scaled. And this plane with the blood effect scales up as soon as it hits the floor, obviously. These few shots are in a separate scene as well, because I had to elongate the roof for it to work. The way the blocks being sliced in half like this was pretty tedious, but simple and self-explanatory. Basically, whenever a block reaches the blade, it teleports back to the starting position, and two halves of a block take its place. So whenever you see a block in this shot that isn't cut in half, it's the same object. For this saber impact, I put a green point light on the fifth brother's face, and the environment texture strength also goes down to 0, which gives the hit a more impactful effect. For this last shot of him falling off the building, I put a big old density cube here so that it could hide the fact that he's just falling onto this building here. And here we have it. This is the last scene. We got some cameos right here. More cameos here. These are some IRL people. Okay, now these over here, these are a couple of interesting cameos. These are my first fully original characters that do have names that I won't reveal just yet, and would be the main characters of a full-on movie that I want to make at some point. It would be set 100 years in the future, but it would be all 80s themes. I'd say it's equally ambitious to say an episode of Songs of War. And yes, that means it would have voice acting. I really want this to be my next big project, and I want to put in as much time as possible into it. So if I fully pursue it, I'm definitely gonna have to update my Blender. But don't get your hopes up too high, because as of right now, I'm not entirely sure how I'm gonna find willing voice actors. But hopefully I'll figure something out at some point down the line.
Okay, editing Chaz here, and I just recently finished writing the script for this particular project that I'm talking about, and look at that. Oh, I cannot wait to tell the story.
Oh yeah, at the end here, I have this green screen circle scale up in the camera, which in post I used to transition to the credits. And honestly, in the final edit, I did not do a good job of covering that up. Anyways, yeah, that's pretty much it for the behind the scenes of Star Wars Imperial Encounters.
Before you go, I have one announcement to make. Hey guys, that's right, Casual Facing Wheel. So what's up? Yeah, I wanted to connect with my audience more, and I feel like this was a good way to do that. I got a haircut just for this, and a significant one too. Just look at that. Should we do a room tour? Come on, let's do a room tour. So y'all saw my Lego Star Wars collection earlier, but what you didn't see was my 40th anniversary Empire Strikes Back poster, and my authentic Sting on the wall there. I also have this Japanese Star Wars poster, all the way from Japan. Here we have pretty much the whole Diary of a Wimpy Kid series. I haven't read the last few because I'm not a kid anymore. And, oh, this first one? Signed by Jeff Kinney. These are all Star Wars books, and this is the old Jedi Academy series. And what's interesting about this one is I actually met the author at Comic-Con 2016, and he drew that for me. Oh yeah, I got this sheath for my lightsaber back at Disney World. This hat I also got at Disney World in 2014. I've kept it since. It's my favorite hat. Let's take a look at my old sketchbook. I used to draw on this all the time. This is probably the most relevant page. I drew this when I was getting into Valve games for the first time. This had to be, I wanna say, 2016 that I did all this. The rest of this sketchbook is full of stuff. There's not enough time to go through it all. I've never been into Nintendo, but I do have these Pokemon cards from like 12 years ago. Are these cards rare? I really wouldn't know. They look rare. Speaking of Valve games, we got the LEGO Dimensions Shell and Wheatley. This Wheatley doesn't actually exist. It's homemade. We also got Funko Death Trooper next to Rex, we got Miles there, Brickhead Stormtrooper, Fredman, Spring Boy, and Gollum. Anyways guys, yeah, that's pretty much it. As for the future, I really want to get started working on character designs, assets, and sets for that movie I was talking about earlier, which by the way, doesn't have a name yet. I'll figure it out eventually. If I do fully commit myself to it, I'm thinking it might end up being like a 5-year project. I've always been against the idea of forming a team. I don't want to rely on people like that and take their time. I am gonna have to figure out voice actors though. That I can't do. So don't expect the channel to be super active for the next while, although I do plan on continuing to make shorts. I always love doing those, as long as I have ideas for some. If I don't end up going through with this project, I'll probably just make a community post saying so. Let's hope it doesn't come to that. Anyways, yeah. That's pretty much all I had to say. See you guys in the next one.
You already know we got the Bible. And we also got that anime Bible, yes sir!